Glory, hallelujah. Lord, I thank you. Thank you, Lord. Oh, yes, Jesus. Glory. Yes. Yes, Lord. Bow with me. Come on, with prayer. Gracious Father, come right now. Again saying thank you. Thank you for this journey that's for today. Oh God, I thank you for lifting me up today, oh Father. Yes, God. Yes, God. Father God, I thank you that you're going to continue to lift me up as I preach your holy word. Oh God, I pray that your word fall upon someone's heart and make them yield to your holy word. God, as I stated earlier, you see and you know what we're going through in this land. But God, I come realizing that God, that you have a plan that we may not see right now. But God, sooner than later, you will reveal your holy plan to us. So Lord, we say thank you. In the name of Jesus, I do pray. Amen. 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 Hallelujah. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Glory. Hallelujah. You know, it's just the feeling when you took me years to realize it, that singing is just not singing. That's ministering. That's ministering through the words of someone. Sometimes you need to let that resonate in your soul and you feel what's being said and not just hear what's being said. God, you lift me up. Oh, glory, hallelujah. Thank you. Yes. Hallelujah, Jesus. Oh, Jesus, thank you. Hallelujah. I don't know about y'all, but I have experienced church services where the preacher didn't even have the opportunity to preach because the Spirit did it all. Sometimes we gotta realize that the Spirit will do the preaching for you. Yes, God, give us a word. But we have to know and understand when the Spirit, when it arrives and do what it does. Hallelujah, Jesus. Yes, I know I got to preach, but he got me excited now. Hey, God, I didn't do it by myself. He lift me up. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you. Thank you. Hallelujah. Mm. Thank you. There's a word from the Lord. Genesis chapter 45, verses 1 through 8. Genesis 45, verses 1 through 8. This is when Joseph reveals his identity to his brothers. And the word of God reads, then Joseph could not refrain himself before all of them that stood by him. And he cried, cause every man to go out from him. And there stood no man with him. While Joseph made himself known unto the brethren. And he wept aloud, and the Egyptians in the house of Pharaoh heard. And Joseph said unto his brethren, I am Joseph. Do with my father yet live? And his brethren could not answer him, for they were troubled at his presence. And Joseph said unto his brethren, come near me, I pray you. And they came near, and he said, I am Joseph, your brother, whom you have sold into Egypt. Now therefore, be not grieved, nor angry with yourselves that ye sold me hither, for God did send me before you to preserve life. For these 2 years have the famine been in the land, and yet there are 5 years in which there shall neither be hearing or harvest. And God sent me before you to preserve you a posterity in the earth, and to save your lives by a great deliverance. So now, it was not for you that sent me hither, but God. And he hath made me a father to Pharaoh, and the Lord of all his house, and a ruler throughout all the land of Egypt. Amen. The reading of God's word for God's people. Hallelujah. If I would lift the subject today, my subject would be God has a plan.
Amen.
We may have plans, but God has a plan. See, this story of Joseph, it starts with chapter 37 of the book of Genesis, and it goes on through chapter 50. So take the opportunities in your times of studies and read from 37 to 50, and you'll get a full understanding of Joseph's life. But we're going to focus on chapter 45, verses 1 through 8. As we, children of God, attempt to find our way through this maze of experience known as life, sometimes becoming lost and confused. But one thing we must never forget is that God has a plan. Sometimes personal misfortunes and tragedy overtakes us, and circumstantial ill wills and ill winds strikes us. When we have reversals in our careers, when sickness and disease attacks our bodies, and when the death angel snatches a loved one from us, our faith is sometimes shaken. And we wonder why these things happen. However, it is all that this maze has to offer. Let us never forget that God has a plan. Yes. Sometimes we earnestly and sincerely pray, and it seems as if our prayers have fallen on deaf ears. Our requests are either denied or the answers delayed. And we feel frustrated and forsaken. As we experience what can be the frustrations as well as the fruit of the earnest prayer, we need to remember that God, whose pleasure it is to give the kingdom to God's children, does not frustrate us unless there is a reason. Therefore, when requests are denied and answers are delayed, let us remember that God has a plan. See, in life, it seems we often see the wicked prosper and the scoundrels enjoy peace. The matter of divine goodness are the questions of suffering, particularly the suffering of the righteous coupled with the good fortunes of the wicked. It continues to be very troubling and a central issue for a faith that affirms the holiness and justice of an all-powerful God. Church family, one may ask, why does God allow bad things to happen to good people? How long will the wrong oppress the right? How much more must the good suffer by the design and at the hand of evil? When is God going to move on our behalf of the innocent and the oppressed, the victimized and the meek? And those who God's word has said will inherit the earth. As we face what we consider to be the great injustices and contradictions of life, let us never forget that there is a divine timetable and a divine way of righting wrongs. Yeah. Therefore, no matter what happens around us, no matter what we see, what we hear, what we read, or what we experience, let us remember that God has a plan. Mm-hmm. If anyone has questions or doubts whether God has a plan, I invite you to consider with me the story of Joseph. Once upon a time in the land of Canaan, there lived a man by the name of Jacob. Some of our lessons and preaching over the previous month. Esau's brother. I know you all remember it. Or some of you all remember the sermon. Hold on to your birthright. Jacob, who had 12 sons. Among the 12 sons, there was one named Joseph, whom he loved more than all the others. Joseph was the child of Jacob's old age. and was the first son given to him by his wife Rachel, whom he loved more than Leah and any of their handmaidens who had also born children of him or from him. As a token of this affection, Jacob gave to Joseph a multicolored cloak that caused Joseph's brothers to resent him and be jealous. Now, Jacob was not denying other sons anything in order to do something special for Joseph. For each of his sons had sufficient food, clothing, and shelter for his needs. Neither was Joseph a threat to their places in Jacob's heart or the legacy he would leave. There was sufficient livestock, land, and money to go around. And each son, by the order of his birth, had legal rights to his father's possession. Yet, the brothers resented the father's affections and gifts to Joseph. Church family, we can have our share of blessings and still be jealous of the blessing that God gives to another child of God. We can have our place in the kingdom and still be jealous of what we see being done for others. Yeah. We can be blessed with talent sufficient for the jobs that we've been called to do and still be jealous when another seems to be multi-talented or multifaceted. We can know and testify to God's goodness and care for others and still be jealous and resentful when God seems to bless someone else with a little more or in a different way than God blesses us. Yes. To make matters worse, Joseph had a habit of dreaming these strange dreams and then telling the others about them. He had a dream in which he and his brothers was binding sheaves in the field, and the sheaves stood upright while the others bowed down to it. He also had another dream in which he saw the sun, the moon, and the stars bowing down to him. When Joseph told his brothers about his dream, their resentment increased. You see, one must be careful in sharing one's visions and dreams with others. Oh, church family, if you want to be something in life, if you want to go places and do things, you must be careful about those whom you share your visions and dreams. Yes. People who don't see visions or have dreams, people whose main concern is protecting their turf and doing the same old thing in the same old way, will not only not understand your dreams, but they will resent you for what they believe is an arrogance and foolishness of your dreams. Jealousy and resentment are terrible diseases because they can cause us to think, say, and do terrible things. You see, one day his brothers were in the field of Dothan watching over their flock. And Joseph, he went to them. When his brothers saw him coming from a long ways off, resentment began to build in their hearts. They said, "Here comes this dreamer. Come on now, let us kill him and throw him into one of the pits. Then we shall say that the wild beast has devoured him, and we shall see what will become of his dreams." Reuben, however, objected to such a foul idea. So they decided not to kill Joseph themselves, but to throw him into one of the pits. Their plans had changed again when they saw an Ishmaelite caravan, which was the descendants of Ishmael, Abraham's oldest son. And they decided to sell Joseph into slavery. They spread animal blood on his coat and took it to Jacob as evidence that a wild beast had killed his beloved son. They sold their brother into slavery, then lied to their father about it. Church family, I have never seen or heard of wrong being done without a lie being required to cover up what was wrong. That's right. When Joseph's brothers sold him, they assumed that they had forever ridded themselves of his presence. But however, they did not know that God had a plan, yes, for Joseph's life. And in their act of treachery and deceit, God was laying the foundation for his fulfillment. Joseph, the object of his father's love and the victim of his brother's resentment. Joseph, whose only crime was being a dreamer in the midst of non-dreaming brethren, was taken to Egypt, and there he was sold again. This time to Potiphar, a captain in the Egyptian army. But in accordance with God's plan, Joseph's certitude was blessed. John Baptist, we as American black people are proof positive that God will provide even in slavery. We are living witnesses that God can open doors and make ways out of no ways, even in slavery. Joseph, he soon became manager of Potiphar's household. But Satan, we must realize that Satan, that's the one we talked about last week. Satan will allow God's children only so much peace before he tries to disrupt their lives. Yes. One day Potiphar's wife approached Joseph with the desire to know him intimately. When Joseph rejected her advances, and Potiphar's wife was convinced that he would not consent to her wishes, she told her husband that it was Joseph who made those advances toward her, and that it was she who had rejected him. So Potiphar, he threw Joseph into prison. Thus the second time, Joseph found himself an innocent victim. Yeah. The first time, his brother's jealousy and resentment had caused him to be sold into slavery. The second time, a woman's lust and resentment had placed him in prison. When Joseph was in prison, Potiphar's wife assumed that she had gotten even. She didn't know, however, that God had a plan for Joseph's life and that God was using her treachery and deceit to bring it to pass. I can just imagine that there were times during his journey from slavery to prison when Joseph must have asked the question, why? Or for what? Perhaps Joseph didn't know that God had a plan for his life and that all the things were working together for his good. Every setback he encountered, every pit that was dug, every trap that was laid, every lie that was told was leading him to where God wanted him to be. Mm-hmm. While in prison, Joseph displayed the same leadership qualities that he had displayed in the Potiphar's house. And soon he became the head trustee. People can't keep one of God's children down. They may try as they might, but God's children will find a way to shine wherever they are or with whatever they're doing. Yes. While in prison, Joseph met the chief butler and the chief baker of Pharaoh's household. They had been locked up because they had done something to anger Pharaoh. Then one night, they both had a dream that they couldn't or didn't understand. Joseph, having had experience with dreams from his childhood, was able to interpret their dreams. You see, if God gives us a gift or a talent, God will also open up a way for that talent to be used. Joseph's interpretation spelled restoration for the butler and death for the baker. However, when the butler was restored to his position in concurrence with Joseph's interpretation, he forgot to tell Pharaoh. He forgot to tell Pharaoh about Joseph's case. See, we need to know sometimes, church family, that people will forget about us once they arrive, once they have made use of what we have to give, once they have what they need for the moment. People will forget, but where people forget, God remembers.
Yes.
We must be mindful though. We must be mindful that if we forget how we made it, God has a way of making us remember.
That's right.
One night about 2 years later, Pharaoh Pharaoh had a dream and that he didn't understand. He dreamed that seven fat cows were grazing in the Nile River when the seven thin cows came up out of the river and devoured them. The thin cows, after eating the fat cows, were just as thin as they were before. But he saw seven plump ears of grain growing on the same stalk. But after 7 years, the withered grain sprang up and consumed the seven plump ears. When the chief butler heard about Pharaoh's dream, he then remembered Joseph, the imprisoned Hebrew, who was the dreamer himself and seemed to have a special gift for discerning dreams. When the butler told Pharaoh about Joseph, and the king sent for him, and Joseph interpreted the dream. He said the seven fat cows and the seven plump ears stands for 7 years of abundance harvest in the land. But these years of plenty will be followed by 7 years of famine, symbolizing by the seven lean cows and the seven withered ears. The time of famine will wipe out the 7 years of abundance. Now watch how Joseph put himself in position to be blessed. He said, what is needed is someone to oversee the harvest so that the grain can be set aside for years of abundance for the time of famine. Then Pharaoh said, I perceive you to be wise with good judgment and a person of integrity. I'm going to put you in charge of Operation Grain Save. And as such, you would have full authority, second in command of the whole land only to me. Joseph did as he was commanded, and the 7 years of abundance was followed by years of famine, just as he said they would come to pass. See, sometime during the second year of famine over in Canaan, an old man by the name of Jacob, who had 11 sons at home, went to the grain barrel one day and saw that the supply was running low. For the famine was widespread. He told his sons, he said, take money and go to Egypt, for I hear there's grain there. And as the old preachers used to say, I can see Joseph in my mind's eye. I can see Joseph as he stood before the storehouse that day, overseeing the sale and distribution of grain. When he saw a caravan approaching him with some familiar faces, I imagine that Joseph could hardly believe his eyes. He said, however, before Joseph had the opportunity to react, his brothers, not recognizing him, had bowed at his feet. As they bowed, Joseph remembered his dream of the 11 sheaves and the 11 stars bowing before him. You see, family, if one is a child of God, one need not to worry about vengeance, for we just follow God's plan if we only trust and obey. Yes. At a time and in a place where it is least expected, God will bring those who try to destroy us, those who laugh at us, those who mock us, those who persecute us, God will bring them to our very feet. After he had questioned him and sent him back home, they returned bringing the youngest brother, Benjamin, back to Egypt. Joseph invited them all to lunch. And after they had done sufficiently, Joseph stood up and said, take a good look at me and tell me if you ever seen me before. Oh, I can imagine Reuben, he started to raise his hand, but he quickly lowered it, saying, you remind me of, but no, this just can't be. I can see Joseph, when he can control his emotions no longer, break down in tears and tell them, I'm your brother Joseph, whom you plotted against and wanted to kill. I'm the same Joseph whom you resented as a child. I'm the same Joseph who you mocked in his dreams. I'm the same Joseph whom you lied to our father about. I'm the same Joseph who you lured into the pit and sold into slavery. But do not grieve, for I bear no ill will. You must answer to God who preserved me in spite of that which you have tried to do to me. For you see, God had a plan for his life. God allowed him to lower him into the pit and sell him into slavery many years ago so that he might feed them at his table at that very moment. Mm-hmm. So it was not, Joseph says, oh, it was not you who sent me here, but God did. Who watched over me and preserved me by divine power and made me a ruler in the land of Egypt. God did it. Joseph said, I'm so glad that God had a plan for our lives. Mm-hmm. And you see, when we finish playing games with one another, when we finish our politics and schemes, our tricks and design, I'm so glad that God has a plan for each and every one of us. And what always fascinates me about God's plan is that God is able to take the evil that people design for our undoings and downfalls and turn around so that it works for our good. Joseph later said to his brothers, you meant it for evil against me, but God meant it for good. I'm so glad that God has a plan for our lives. But Jesus came in according with God's plan. When Satan decided that he would hold humanity captive, God had a plan for our redemption. Wrapped in love, wrapped in grace, wrapped in truth, God stepped across time and was born as a baby in Bethlehem. He grew up into a man who refused to compromise with Rome. And when Satan and the forces of evil decided that they would destroy him by subjecting him to the worst possible death that they knew, death on the cross, Jesus declared that he would take that same cross that degraded others and use it as a pledge for our redemption. For he said, if I be lifted up from the earth, will draw all men unto me. The cross that evil used to shame a perfect Christ became God's plan for a pledge for our redemption. God had a plan. God had a plan for the one that came down through 42 generations. God had a plan for the one that died on Calvary. God had a plan. Yes, he had a plan for that one that got up on that third day morning. But all power in his hand. God had a plan. God has a plan for you. God has a plan for us all. There may be someone out there that has not accepted the Lord Jesus as your personal Savior. You can do so at this time, because he does have a plan for your life. There may be someone out in virtual land that has not accepted Christ as their Savior. This is your time for God to reveal your plan to you by accepting him as your personal Savior. If you need to, you can do that today. Right where you are, to stop what you're doing and say, Lord, I surrender. I surrender to you. Hallelujah. Do we have anyone? And the ones out in virtual land, if you need any more assistance with accepting Christ as your personal Savior, you can go to our Facebook page, you can go to our web page, you can go to our YouTube page. Contact anybody from the church. And we'll be glad to come with you and pray with you. Help you. Allow God to reveal the plan that he has for your life. Yes. Hallelujah. Yes. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. 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 Thank you, Lord. God has a plan for us all. Amen. Amen. Now, time for our benediction. Lord, I ask now that the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit remain with us all until we meet again. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah.